Good morning and welcome to Let's Talk Autism with Shannon and Nancy. I'm Nancy Alspaugh-Jackson.
And I'm Shannon Penrod.
Hi.
And I was just saying, we don't have enough time. There's too many things to cover. And you said all we have is time.
Well, that's a quote that I once read, which is kind of true. It's really all we do have is our time and how it's how up to us how we choose to spend it, right?
Absolutely.
So, but there, I'm like you. I always want 20 more hours in a day.
And I always remember the quote that you have the exact same number of hours that Mother Teresa has.
Right.
Okay,
and I'm
that's
like, a good one too.
All right, well.
Okay, that's enough to make us
all
feel like
But she's not
slackers.
Watching cable TV
no,
is the
she's
thing
not.
That I would respond
no,
to
No, she
that.
Was not.
Right.
So,
not,
but we
wasn't.
Do have a lot in the news that we want to jump right into because obviously with Autism Awareness Month, and I brought in a little thing that I had written that you hadn't seen, the month for awareness and activism.
Yes.
There's a lot going on, and one of the things is the controversy surrounding President Trump. Shared, I guess he tweeted a photograph of the White House lit up blue.
Yes, and he put out a proclamation.
Yes.
But for the first time, the White House was lit up blue. There have been buildings all across the, you know, the pyramids
the world.
Of Giza
yes.
have been lit up blue for lighted up blue for World Autism Awareness Day. But and many of us, myself included, wrote letters to the White House in previous administrations and begged. Could they please, I wrote a letter personally to Michelle Obama and said, I'm just asking you mom to mom, could you put a blue light bulb on your porch?
Yeah,
you know,
big porch.
To show that you understand that there are a lot of us that are going through this. And there was always silence.
Right.
And this year, for the first time, the White House was lit up blue.
President Trump did it in honor of the Suzanne Wright. And
he
it's
promised
in honor of the
her.
Wrights because he promised Suzanne before she passed away last year. This past year, not too long ago.
Yes.
Bob and Suzanne Wright, of course, the founders of Autism Speaks. So he promised them and he went through it. So Shannon and I think it's great that this happened.
I really appreciate it.
Yeah.
And I need to say that out loud, that I really appreciated it. I know that it was met with a great deal of controversy. He put out some tweets about it, and he also put out his proclamation. He used the word cure in his proclamation, and a lot of people had a lot to say about that. There are a whole lot of people who don't like Autism Speaks, so they don't participate in the Light It Up Blue. They don't like it, I think, which is part of the reason why nobody has lit up the White House before, but... President Trump is not the only one who took some flack for his activities over World Autism Awareness Day.
William Shatner, the actor,
has taken a great deal of flack.
Changed his icon and tweeted his support to draw awareness for the disability. And Shannon, that set off a huge controversy, right?
A huge controversy that continues. He has been in there was a tweet sort of... I won't say a battle, let's not, you know, over-dramatize it, but there were many tweets that were going back and forth between William Shatner and ASN, the Autism Self-Advocate Network, and in particular Ari Neem, and he's not the only one. Paul Ryan took a little bit of a beating in the social networking arena because he wore a blue pin on his lapel. In honor of World Autism Awareness Day, and a lot of people were tweeting him and saying, well, if you want to be in support, then how about a healthcare bill that actually covers things having to do with autism? It's a tough environment. I gotta say, I have concerns. I really want everybody to feel free to have their opinions about whatever charities they like or don't like. I think everybody's entitled to think whatever they want to think. But when we start, if somebody steps forward and does anything in support of anyone on the autism spectrum and we, you know, beat them down, we cannot wonder why people don't come forward and support other things.
That's right, because it's just controversy, I think, within our own community, fighting others in our community, to me seems to defeat the purpose of everything.
And I will say this, you know, I mean, the things that were being tweeted at William Shatner saying, you know, how can you support an organization that the word that was used was that they support eugenics.
Yes, which is really going a little bit.
I think that's a stretch.
Yeah, I think it's a big stretch.
You know, it's accusing Autism Speaks of wanting to cleanse to have a better race. I really think that I personally don't agree with that. I want to be welcoming of people to have whatever reaction that they have to it, because I can't speak to them. But I do think that it's harsh to, you know, I'll be next. I don't support everything that Autism Speaks does, but I have supported over the years and continue to support some of the things that they do. I am not in favor of eugenics at all.
The awareness they've brought to autism in general has been a really good thing. You had brought to my attention an article written by a parent who says, we're all aware of autism, now let's do something radical. And she was approached for a donation for Autism Speaks, I believe, or another charity for Autism Awareness Month. And she said no, because she was in a hurry because her 8-year-old son was about to have a tantrum. And she talks about the need for doing something, i.e., I guess, finding a cure or treatment, because her son is severely affected. And
she says, do something radical. Invite a person with autism to a birthday party.
Right.
Like, you know, say to a parent, do you need
that's
help?
That's really more. Yeah.
Yeah, like that's the radical.
The radical is to instead of just saying, oh, I'm aware, to actually help someone with autism. And I just want to take this moment to plug ACT Today by saying awareness is really, truly needed. But at ACT Today, we're asking people to be an activist by supporting ACT Today and their programs, because we have so many things that they're not controversial in the slightest. There's special needs summer programs, there's social skills learning, there's assistive technology, there's medical help, there's safety today, stop autism death by elopement, there's special help for military families and Hispanic families. So you can take action by going to act-today.org, and you can make a donation to help someone with autism Absolutely. Get a treatment that can help make their life better. And I don't think there's any, how can you argue that?
Absolutely. And then we've got so much in the news to cover. I don't want to not talk about the fact that late last night, Vice President Pence, was on the Hill and proposing a new health care bill to House Republicans that really got together with the more conservative end of things to talk about what the House Freedom Caucus. And there are a couple of things that we want to bring to your attention to let you know, because it was late last night, and I know this morning I was like, what happened? There are a couple of points in this bill that we, as parents of individuals who are on the autism spectrum and individuals who are on the autism spectrum, we need to be aware of. And one of them is that the essential health benefits package, which requires insurers to cover at minimum 10 categories of medical care, including hospital trips, doctor visits, maternity care, and mental health benefits, which is what ABA comes under. They're saying that that could be put back to the states and that they could decide whether they'd like to participate or not. We fought so hard to get that included in there. Behavioral health included in the 10 essential. If it goes to the states, people are going to lose their ABA. The community rating provision, which requires insurers to charge sick people the same prices as health people, that's under fire.
I can revert back to the state, yeah.
Guaranteed issue requirement, which prevents insurers from denying coverage to people with pre-existing conditions.
Such as autism.
So this is a pretty important thing. They're asking for you to talk to members, especially of the Republican Party, who are a little bit on the fence of this,
right,
and that they want to listen. A couple of weeks ago, when the first bill was taken to the House, we were all being told, call. I know I called my representative, and they were like, we are marking down,
right,
and you know, and wanting to know from you. So there's a long list of people from many different states that goes onto the back of this page. We don't really have time to read them all, but maybe we can post this on the Facebook page.
Yep, so they
people can
know
link
where to go
directly
to
them.
Representative,
but you've
maybe.
Got to be calling your representatives, especially these core. There's about 30 of them that are on the fence.
Right.
And we cannot afford to lose this 10 essential
no,
health
can't.
Benefits.
It's, we can't
I can
afford
hear
to.
The toilet flushing in the background.
We can't
Let's not
afford
do that.
To.
Now, having said that, we've got some great guests that are on the show. We're
yes.
starting first with a guest who's coming to us from Lineagen.
Yes.
We've had Lineagen before on the show, and they do genetic testing.
Lineagen is a genetic testing
so,
company.
So Megan Martin,
out of Utah.
Who is
uh-huh.
the director of clinical genetic services, is going to be with us after this break. But don't forget that later on in the hour, we're having Dr. Bob Schultz. He's the director of the Center for Autism Research, CAR, without the D,
mm-hmm.
not CARD, CAR. And we're going to be talking with him about this. We mentioned this on the show a couple of months ago.
The new
study looking at MRIs to be able to predict
and
autism.
Brain mechanisms that
and
can
seeing the differences,
it. Yeah.
seeing
yeah.
that, you know, that sudden onset of growth that
uh-huh.
happens. And
we'll hear about
why,
that study,
why we
which
care
is
about that.
Got, you know, got a lot of promise.
Yeah, so we're going to take a break and back with Megan Martin from Lineagen. Stick with us.
Nobody ever asks a kid with autism, what is it you'd really like to do? At this school, we ask the kids, what is your goal? What is your dream? Exceptional Minds is a vocational training program for young adults on the autism spectrum who want to have careers in computer animation and visual effects. I think young people with autism are totally underestimated.
When you've met one person with autism, you've met one person with autism. They all have different talents, different skills, and what surprised me is that there really are no limits, that if these guys believe that they can do something, they really can.
It's estimated that 90 to 95% of young adults with autism are unemployed or underemployed.
A lot of young adults still live at home. A lot of them suffer from depression and are very isolated from the rest of the world, and the opportunities for them are very limited.
We want to develop careers for our young adults. Our full-time program runs 3 years, at the end of which we have job placement and job coaching. We have a work readiness program. We also have our own in-house studio so that when our students graduate, they can do on-the-job training and work on real projects.
We outsourced about 30, 40 shots to the team here. They did fantastic work that we can put into a movie and be proud of it. It's great. I mean, we want to do it again.
The studio is their first step into the professional world, the first step in their new careers as digital artists.
The whole purpose is to get the students out into the real world.
We all have the same dreams. We want significance, dignity, and purpose with our lives. We have an opportunity to give those three words to every single student at this school who will actually be able to go out and participate in the dream.
This is my first full-time, full-paying job. I primarily work in After Effects. I learned After Effects at Exceptional Minds. It seemed like a good place for me to fit in because I was interested in animation.
Right from the first day that Nikki set foot in our company, he was producing work for us. We saw what level of professionalism is being instilled in them from the very beginning.
This was the first opportunity where Nikki could combine something he loved to do with something he was really, really good at that could eventually lead to employment.
When we first met Kevin, he was working at a supermarket bagging groceries, and they said he would never amount to anything else.
I work at Stargate Studios, and I'm a junior compositor. I mainly do like rotoscoping right now, and I'm still learning.
I think that you find great talent in the most amazing places. The students at Exceptional Minds have had a fair amount of training to get them ready for the visual effects environment.
If it wasn't for Exceptional Minds, I might still be at the supermarket, and I might be living at my parents' house.
Everything's changed. Nikki has purpose.
It feels like I'm a member of society now.
He's capable of making it on his own.
once you get inside and you see what's really happening there, you immediately want to be a part of it.
It's the dream factory, you know, the movie business. And if you can connect people with their dreams, then the magic happens.
At Exceptional Minds, we like to say that we are changing lives one frame at a time.
And we are back, and we are joined by a special guest. We have Megan Martin. She is the Director of Clinical Genetic Services at Lineagen. And as Director of Clinical Genetic Services, she leads Lineagen's genetic counseling and cytogenetics team. And under her leadership, the clinical services team provides physicians and families with consultation, education, and support throughout the genetic testing and evaluation process. Megan is licensed and certified genetic counselor, has been with Lineagen in Salt Lake City, Utah for 6 years. Welcome to the show, Megan.
Thank you for having me.
Good to have you here. And let's start with, why is genetic testing important for people with ASD if they already have a diagnosis?
Yeah, that's a great question. And actually one of the common questions we receive from many families and physicians. And when a person receives a diagnosis of autism, that's really only describing the symptoms that are being observed in that individual. It doesn't get down to the question of why are these symptoms present? What is the cause? And so a genetic diagnosis can help provide basically like a roadmap to say, okay, if we have a better understanding of what the genetic condition is that's relating or causing the symptoms of autism in this individual, what can we do to provide better care? An analogy for this is like if you have a sore throat and go to a doctor, that doctor is going to look at kind of the cause of why do you have that sore throat, because that's going to impact their treatment plan for you. So similarly, with a genetic diagnosis, you can have a better kind of understanding of what treatment therapies, kind of approach to the medical care may be better for that individual versus others, individual without that genetic condition. And genetic testing has actually become more and more common in individuals with autism. And recent studies have shown that up to 26% of people with autism spectrum disorder do have an underlying genetic change that are related to those symptoms that we're seeing in that individual.
Well, and Megan, you mentioned that sometimes it can change what happens with the treatment. Can you give us an example of how it does change the treatment?
Yeah. So I kind of like to think of a genetic diagnosis, again, as providing a roadmap. It's not a crystal ball. None of us have a crystal ball of what we're going to anticipate for our life. But let's say we have a genetic diagnosis and we identify it in an individual. We can actually look and say, how have other children grown and developed with that same condition? What medical risks are they potentially at higher risk for than the general population? Are there any medical complications that we should have on our radar? Sometimes there's different therapeutic approaches that may be more effective. And also this information can be really helpful for families who have questions about, is this going to happen again? What is the chance for this to happen again? A genetic diagnosis can provide insight into those types of questions. And actually, I think it's best kind of demonstrated through a case study, a case that we actually recently had here at Lineagen. And I counseled this family who had a five-year-old daughter who had delayed milestones. So she wasn't meeting her milestones. She did have a diagnosis of autism spectrum disorder, but the family really didn't feel like that completely described what was going on. It wasn't a very good fit for her. She had particular difficulties in expressive language skills and was undergoing pretty extensive speech therapy. And unfortunately, wasn't really making much progress in that area. And she was entering kindergarten, and the family had big questions about, what do we do from here? How do we provide the best environment, educational environment, therapeutic environment, and medical approach for them? So this individual's pediatrician noticed, you know, these symptoms, autism, and these questions that this family had, and ordered a particular genetic test called chromosomal microarray, and it looks at changes in the chromosomes, particularly missing or extra pieces of those chromosomes. So this test was done for this little girl, and lo and behold, we find that she has an extra piece of chromosome 15. And this particular genetic change causes a condition called Dup15q syndrome. So now knowing this, we can look and say, okay, well, what is the experience of those individuals with this specific genetic syndrome, and how have they, you know, kind of encountered medical challenges? We realize that individuals with this particular syndrome have a high risk for seizures, usually in early childhood. Now, she didn't have any signs of seizures, but they're knowing this diagnosis got her into an immediate evaluation with a neurologist to look for maybe unrecognized signs of seizure activity. Additionally, with this particular condition, unfortunately, these individuals just don't often obtain very much speech. And so knowing this, there've been a lot of great advances in the therapeutic approach that families have learned with alternative methods such as picture exchange or sign language that has been particularly effective with encouraging that communication. Okay. So now knowing all this information, this family can take this information to their medical providers, to the therapist, and also actually include this information in the IEP to provide an overall specialized care plan for this.
Great. So it can help families develop a treatment plan. Now, there are different types of genetic testing available. How does it compare to testing for medication management?
Yeah. We can look at our genetics in many different ways, and the particular type of genetic test that is selected depends upon the question that you're hoping to answer. So as an example, there is a genetic test, we call it pharmacogenomic testing, and what that does is it looks at common genetic changes in individuals. We all have these genetic changes, and it actually impacts how our body responds to certain medications. So knowing this information, it can actually help us with dosing and selection of medications that may be more effective for that individual. Now, conversely, we do also offer another genetic test called the chromosomal microarray. Again, that looks at deletion and duplications, so missing or extra pieces of the genetic material, and that's more of a diagnostic genetic test. We're looking at the underlying reason of why we are seeing these symptoms in this individual. And those deletion and duplication syndromes can be one of the most common causes, genetic causes, of autism that we see.
And Megan, I'm sure a lot of people are wondering as they're watching this, is this something that they have to pay for out of pocket, or is this covered by insurance?
Yeah. Many of the genetic tests are currently included in medical guidelines, so professional medical organizations and associations have issued statements to, you know, who are candidates and when to use this type of testing. And because of that, many insurers do cover this testing because it is in the guidelines.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
Wonderful.
So how do families learn more and about having their child tested? Where can they learn more?
Yeah, we actually have a website that families can go to. But first, this is a genetic test. All of our genetic tests do have to be ordered by a medical provider. And we feel very strongly about assisting families in that process of getting their doctor to order this testing and have access to this testing. So if you are interested in this testing, you can go ahead and go online, lineagen.com, and you'll see on the first page, I'm a parent. Click on that. It'll take you to a new page and click on sign up for testing. So that will take you to an information sheet that you can fill out, learn more information, and kind of see the next steps of where to go from there.
Wonderful. We have that up on our screen right now, lineagen.com. We just have that up on our screen, lineagen.com. All right. Thank you. This is very valuable information, and we encourage parents interested to go to the website and check it out.
Thank you so much, Megan.
Thank you, Megan. Good to see you.
And give our love to everybody at Lineagen.
Yes. Thank you.
All right. Bye-bye.
All right. You take care. Bye-bye. Wonderful. And so we're going to take a short break, and then we are going to be back with Dr. Bob Schultz, and we're going to talk about brain imaging to predict autism.
It's a big study that was in the news just a couple of weeks ago that, you know, got a lot of attention. So we have the actual director of the Center for Autism Research here to talk about that study when we come back.
Stick with us.
Hey, everybody. This is Joe Morisi. We're here live in Fullerton, California at the historic Fox Theater. And we're here tonight for the fourth annual comedy show for autism put on by the Fullerton Cares Foundation. And we're just hanging out outside the theater here. And we're going to go talk to some folks right now and see what brought them out tonight.
My name is Larry Hauser. I'm the founder of the Fullerton Cares Autism Foundation, and the one putting on this whole event, me and my crew.
Larry, doing this for 4 years, what is it that you like best about this event?
What I like best about this event is there's a lot of people in this area that don't normally go to walks or any stuffy fundraiser events. This is something that those people don't come to, but they want to support. So that's why I really love this particular event, is because of that.
A lot of fun. Now, who do I have the pleasure of speaking with here?
I am the Fullerton School District Board President, and I'm taking a lot of the money from tonight. This is a wonderful event, and we can't wait to have the comedy and raise the money for a worthy cause.
Events, try to help raise money for the events, and seems like I said, Larry seems to do all the work and get the crew going, and he just directs us around, and we try to pick up the cash for him.
Awesome, Brian. And Brian, what is it in your 4 years coming to the event? What is it that you like the most about it?
The comedians. I mean, last year we had a full lineup. This year, I think the lineup's going to be even better, and I mean, you can't beat it.
The event is the way that our community comes together. That everybody supports Fullerton Cares and supports the families that are part of Fullerton and that show up and create a really great environment for our kids to grow up in.
And I'm actually out here to support my good friend Larry Hauser. Happy to be back and happy to support my buddy.
What I like the best is the amount of people that actually come out and support us and support the cause, because they know it's a good cause, it's a local cause, local charity, and so it's just nice to see the community come together for something that's for the community.
Welcome back. Nancy and I are really excited because joining us via Skype right now, we have Dr. Robert Schultz. He's the director of the Center for Autism Research, CAR, CAR. They're a multifaceted research program at CHOP, working to understand the causes of autism spectrum disorders and to develop better treatments. The group's research addresses the basic mechanisms that support social communication, attention, and the biology of reinforcement-based learning, which is a mouthful, but really important. And you guys probably are more familiar with Dr. Schultz because, in fact, we covered it here on the show. There was a study just a couple of months ago that got everybody's attention, looking at predicting autism using MRI and looking at a phenomenon that happens that we're going to talk to Dr. Schultz a little bit more to see what he saw. So first of all, Dr. Schultz, you've got a resume that is amazing. You are a very impressive gentleman, and we're lucky to have you working on the field of autism.
That's kind of you to say. I appreciate it.
Well, we're really excited to have this opportunity to talk with you. So we covered the rudimentary parts of the study here on the show, but neither one of us is a scientist. So let's start with, what did your study set out to find?
Okay, so we want to understand the earliest manifestations of autism. That's kind of hard to study because, in general, it's hard to predict who's going to go on to have autism. So So we had to use a specific group of kids to look at. And those are kids where there's already a brother or a sister with autism. We call those high-risk samples or baby sibling samples. So if we were to study just the general population, we would have to study hundreds and hundreds of kids just to get a few kids with autism. But if we study a high-risk sample, about 1 out of 5 or 20% will have autism.
And you're looking to find the earliest possible moment that you can identify in the brain when it's happening? Is that correct?
That's correct, but even more than that, it's not just the brain. We want to look at the behavior as well. Because we don't know the first signs of autism from a research point of view, because we're usually not there to study it. It usually happens and it goes on for a period of months before a parent would come to a clinician, before a clinician might then suggest a research study. And so we've been in, as a scientific community, we've been in the dark about the very, very earliest or the onset of autism.
Okay.
And we think that's going to provide clues that you just otherwise don't get.
So tell us what the study, what did you find out with the study?
So we found out that in the first year of life, that the rate of brain growth is different in kids who go on to have autism.
And why is that? Do we know?
We can speculate. We can speculate. But maybe I should tell you a little bit more specifically about the kinds of changes we saw. So the brain, as you know, has neurons and connections. The connections are white matter. The neurons are gray matter. They actually literally look gray if you look at the brain. And the outside of the brain is the big part, is the cortex. That's the part that's most enlarged in humans compared to any other animal. And the rate of the growth of the cortex in particular regions was happening very quickly between 6 and 12 months of age. So if you look at the growth rate, that told us at age 2 who was going to have autism. And that's important for a couple reasons, but your last question was on why might that be. It's definitely something that, and what we used for this study was MRI, magnetic resonance imaging, which is great for giving us really clear pictures of the brain anatomy, the different folds, but it can't see cells. It can't see the individual neurons in the brain. So the question of why is it happening is something that an MRI can't tell us. But there's been a lot of other research that provides strong hints as to why. So we've, meaning the community, not my lab, have studied animals where we might engineer them to have an autism risk gene. We know that there's 100 or so autism risk genes. If you put them in an animal, you can find features of autism, such as a brain that grows too fast in the first year of life. And when that happens, it's because you've heard of stem cells, haven't you?
Yes, of course.
So stem cells are kind of pluripotent. They can develop in any direction. The stem cells in the brain are special because they grow during the first weeks of life. And you don't get neurons or other or types of neurons. You just get stem cells. It turns out that when you have a lot of stem cells born in the first 50 days of life, you get an overall bigger brain. So it's possible that the roots of this could go back to early prenatal development, that there's more stem cells being born. And after about day 50, those stem cells begin to give rise to daughter cells, which are all sorts of different kinds of neurons, specific names, like projection neurons or local circuit neurons. That's not, those things don't dictate or predict the ultimate size of the brain. So it's probably something in the timing of early divisions of cells in the first 50 days of life. But we don't know that from our data, right? So we know that we've seen the brain size increase in a very specific way, in a very specific part of the cortex. And we know from animal research why that is. So we're now speculating that we can use the animal research to guess why it is in the kids that we study.
Certainly helps. Yeah. That's interesting to know. When your study came out, all the headlines were saying, that there was a possibility of another way of looking to predict early autism. And we know that the earlier the diagnosis, the better the outcomes tend to be.
Right.
But does this suggest then that people should start having their children get MRIs really young?
Not yet. It's this was a big study, and it took 10 years to do the study, believe it or not. But it wouldn't be prudent to rush and do that. Good science means we should replicate it first. We should actually do the study again, and we should estimate with precision what is the accuracy of this test. So in our study, we were about 90% accurate in predicting who would get autism, which is good. But from a public health perspective, sometimes even 90% isn't good enough to warrant the expense of an MRI. But more importantly, I think is we need to be really confident in that number, 90%, and we need to know the range of possible predictions.
And tell us again how young you were able to predict it with this, with your technology.
So at 12 months of age, we could predict.
It's amazing.
Because the rate of growth between 6 and 12. So we had to look at both the 6-month brain and the 12-month brain. So we had to get 2 MRIs.
And 15 of the children in the original study ended up being diagnosed with autism. Have they all started treatment?
So I'm sure they have. We have not followed them up to track that. We get, fortunately, nice funding from the NIH and the NIMH and the NICHD. But we haven't yet gotten follow-up money to ask those really important questions. We've applied, and we're hopeful that we will. And many of these kids now are, 7, 8, 9, 10 years old. And so we're really curious as you all know, autism is heterogeneous. So some of these kids will be doing really well, some of them doing less well, some of them will do well in school but not socially, and so on. We want to know if we can actually understand more than just this binary classification, do you have autism or not, but what predicts very specific outcomes, what predicts who responds well to certain kinds of treatments. All those things are questions which would be important to get answers to.
Yeah, and so funding is what's preventing you from being able to get those answers at this point?
Correct. I don't know how much you know about the lives of researchers, but we live and breathe on funding.
Yeah.
We're what you call soft money. We're always applying for grants, and the research we do is the research we get funded to do, and it's it can be unpredictable how that's going to work out.
And we haven't really talked about this, but is there a risk associated with getting MRIs when a child is really young? Is there any negative to doing this?
No known risks for MRI. It doesn't involve like X-rays. It doesn't involve what's called ionizing radiation. It's really a big, it's a big magnet and an FM radio signal. It's like an FM radio station that you plug and aim it at the brain while it's in a magnetic field. And the resonance is because the water molecules in the brain resonate. They wiggle, and we perturb their wiggle with the FM radio station.
Interesting. I didn't know that. Good to know. Well, I think the biggest question is here, how do people find out more so that if you're doing another study and they want to participate, and if heaven help us, if there's somebody out there who's got a checkbook and wants to write you a check to further look at this study, where would they go?
So I can give you some websites for us. Can I read them to you?
Yes, yeah, please.
So there's www.autismlive.com. And then all one word, which is our name of our organization, centerforautismresearch.org. And you can find out more about our research, if you go to the research and news section. People who are interested in helping with the study could email me directly if they wish, and I'm happy to give you that email.
Okay.
And that's Schultz, S-C-H-U-L-T-Z, R-T for my initials, Robert Thomas, at chop.edu.
Okay.
All right. And any others?
I should say that this work is, I want to make it clear, we are one of several sites who work together. So you're talking to me, but there are a lot of other people throughout the country who help. So there's a group in Seattle. The main group is actually in Chapel Hill, North Carolina. There's a group in St. Louis. So the children came from all these groups. And we now have 500 children who have enrolled and who we've evaluated up through 36 months. So it's important really to wait to 36 months to understand the diagnosis. And so we will be publishing many, many more things about this over the next couple of years, as well as we're hopeful we'll get funding to understand how these early signs help us understand, you know, later outcomes.
I just want to know, at what point did you get excited and go, we really have something here?
You know, it, believe it or not, 9 years into it, that's the nature of research. You have to stick with the things for a long time, because you can't, in a reproducible and a reliable way, look at your results until you have enough people in the sample. And the kinds of analyses we did on the brain and the kind of statistics we did really required a big team of people. So it takes time. But no, we all slogged away for many hours, for many years, knowing that it was an important thing to do regardless of what we found. We've known for a long time that kids with autism on average have bigger heads and bigger brains. We just didn't know the origin of it. And we didn't know when it began, and we didn't know if it would predict. We didn't know if we could see features in the first year of life that would help us understand what a child will be like when they're two or three. So that was the kind of risky part. That was the thing we were hoping would find.
It's a really big deal, and I just want to thank you. We want to thank you for the work that you did in having that patience, because I do think that moving forward in the next decade, it's going to make a huge difference.
I do too. I think this is really important. The existing, so there's no other way to predict autism in the first year of life. And the existing tools, which are generally like parent questionnaires, really aren't that accurate. And they're not even functional until age, say, 2 years of age. So it's really not predicting autism.
And to piggyback onto that, let's say this, that both Nancy and I are autism parents, and you know, people don't listen to autism parents.
A lot of times pediatrician, and
right,
they won't listen.
To have something to point to and say, look, it's right here, it's not in my head, this is what's happening, that's a huge gift that you've given to the autism parents.
And this might be a question that you don't have the answer to at this point, but when do you think something like this would be available mainstream, on a wider spread basis, if your research continues to go as you anticipate?
So the process will unfortunately take years. There'd have to be another study that proved that this wasn't a one-time fluke, this result. And then you'd have to go through the process of getting an indication through the FDA. There's an application process and a proof process, and that would take also several years. So unfortunately, there's nothing quick about this, but that's wise, because you don't want to expose families to the trouble and the hopes, the false hopes of MRI in the first year of life, or the expense of it, until you're really certain. So although it's hard to wait, I think it's the right call.
Well, you have our support, and thank you so much. You have our gratitude as well. This is really amazing, and 10 years work, but it's really paying off. We want to thank you and everyone there at the Center for Autism Research. And whenever you have something you'd like to share, we'd love to have you come back.
I would love to come back. We have a lot of cool stuff, so you'll be hearing.
All right.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Schultz.
Thank you so much. Right. Bye-bye.
Okay.
Really amazing.
Yeah.
When I think about 10 years ago where I was when they started this, and how I hoped that there were people, that there were brighter minds,
yes,
who were doing something. I'm not a patient person.
Yeah.
I like that bone I did not get when I came out. But 10 years goes by in the blink of an eye.
It goes by in the blink of an eye.
And here we are, and we know more than we did then. It really gives me chills to think about the fact that they were there slogging away at it, taking the data and doing whatever, and parents were participating and taking their kids in and getting MRIs and wondering, is any of this ever going to mean anything to anybody? But if we get to the point, let's talk about this just for a second. If we get to the point where kids can be reliably diagnosed at 12 months, it will save so much time.
Yes.
It will save so much money. It will save so much heartache.
And also, it will save people from wondering, because if they don't have a clear idea, if they think their child might have autism, but there's, you know, their pediatrician might be saying, oh, they're a late talker.
It will get rid of incompetence on the personal level. And, you know, we always talk on this show, the reason why we talk about early intervention is It's just like anything else. If you get behind in your house payments, mm-hmm. it's like, okay, well, I'm only 1 month behind, right. but I still have to make the one this month, mm-hmm. right? And this is when the whole housing collapse happened and people said, how did so many people get foreclosed upon? Because if you start getting behind, you still have to keep up with what's going on. Same thing for our kiddos. So if they miss the milestones at a year, but now they're supposed to be working on the ones that happen at 14 months,
right.
and they're still working on them. So you just get further and further. So if you get to a child who's 8 years old, what we have to catch up on is so much while they keep being bombarded by new stuff that mm-hmm. often it makes it really difficult, if not possible, to completely get caught up.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas we know for some of the kids that are being diagnosed at 15 months,
right.
those kids are getting to be the age 3 and not having an autism diagnosis
right.
and go through their life and are fine because we're catching them before they're so far behind.
Mm-hmm.
My son diagnosed at 2.5. It took us 5 years to get caught up.
My you son diagnosed at 4 and at 4 or 3.5 to 4 and started therapy at 4.75.
Right. So. And it's an endless battle
right.
to get
right.
caught up and to,
right.
and you still have to deal with the medical things
right.
and you got to deal with other things. It's hard on the parents. It's hard on the kids. You know, it makes such a difference if we can get there earlier. And I think for parents, peace of mind too, to know, oh, okay, it is autism. We don't have to guess. We can look at it on an MRI. There
right.
it is. It's
right.
autism. This is, and to know, you know, which type of autism, this is what we do.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it's going to make a tremendous difference.
It sure is.
What a body of work to have done. You know,
yeah.
we hear all the time people will say, you know, they're working the first line of their obituary, right?
Right.
A maudlin way of looking at it, but it means that what you're doing is so important
right.
that it's what will be said about you when you're no longer here. We want to thank everybody at CAR, and we want to thank everybody, we want to thank Viri Diana for making sure that we got this interview.
Yeah, this is a great interview.
All right.
So,
we'll take a short break and come back.
Take a very short break.
We actually had an article about stem cells.
Oh,
that we
did.
Didn't get
do you
to.
Want to just cover
it?
You want to do,
do want
instead
to
of
it,
taking
not go
a
to
break,
break,
we'll.
Let's see if we
yeah,
can find
let's
it.
See,
cautious
I've got
optimism.
It right here.
Okay.
It starts off with a story of a little girl who took part in the study.
And this was covered, we should say. CNN covered this morning, and also Fox.
Oh, did they? Okay.
Fox News covered it this morning.
She was one of the good outcomes of this story of this one little girl that was part of it. And the study, the goal was to see whether a transfusion of their own umbilical cord containing rare stem cells could help treat their autism. So parents that banked their
yes.
stem their own umbilical cord.
And people
cord.
Have been doing this for years, by
yes.
the way. This is
yes.
not new.
And this study at the Carolina's Cord Blood Bank at Duke Medical University had some very impressive results. And the children traveled to Duke 3 times over the course of the year. They underwent a series of evaluations and autism assessments. And then each child received 1 billion to 2 billion cells given through an IV in the arms or legs. And then at 6 months and then a year later, the children returned for more tests and observation. And many of these children did very well.
Yeah. And we should say, I mean, I had a radio show before this. We haven't mentioned this, but today marks 5 years of Autism Live.
Oh, really?
5
Congratulations.
Years. Yeah, thank you. And before that, I did 3 years of Everyday Autism Miracles. And so 8 years that I can say people were talking about this 8 years ago because I was covering it then. And there were parents who had stored their cord blood and that were able to do that. And it was kind of a mixed bag. From the people that I spoke to, there were some that saw a tremendous difference. There were some that saw a little bit of improvement. And there were some, unfortunately, that said we just didn't see a big, big difference. And a lot of this came about because there was a child with other difficulties. I think there was cerebral palsy that had a stem cell transplant, and it was huge.
Yes, it's not just with autism that they're using this.
Yes.
They're using it with other conditions as
well.
But
people got very excited with autism, and we should be clear that if you have saved your cord blood, you have the right to do with that cord blood. If you have a physician who's willing to inject it back into your child, there's nothing illegal about
right.
that. However, that has led to some conversations about would other stem cell, because for other things that are out there. There is stem cell research being done and therapy that you can get somebody else's stem cells. I was not able to store, I couldn't afford it. It was $20,000 to store.
They said, and they said, don't go run out and store stem cells because of this particular study. They need to do a double blind study on this.
Right.
This is an initial.
But, you know, now it is infinitely less expensive to store your stem cells. Yeah. I know we certainly looked at it 14 years ago when we were pregnant with Jem, and I know you adopted Wyatt,
right.
So it wasn't really
right, it was
an
adopted
option
at birth.
And but you know, it was $20,000 when we to start it, and then there were upkeep on it 14 years ago. It's a lot less expensive now, but it right now the only thing you can do for the treatment of autism is if you have stored the cord blood yourself,
right,
and have the stem cells.
Apparently, with this one little girl Gracie in the article, they said the best investment they ever made was the $2,000 spent on banking her cord blood.
Right, but she's significantly younger. It has gone down so much in price. I hear from people now that it's much more affordable, and that it can be a good thing if, for instance, other things happen, such as leukemia. That's why we were looking at it 15 years ago. But $20,000, I didn't have it in the couch cushions.
So $2,000, if that's what they spent just, you know, when she went through the tests,
right,
it must be much lower than that right now.
Yeah, so you would think.
Okay.
Which is great, technology making it
wonderful.
Easier to do that might be something for people to look at.
So, what?
Okay, we have a picture of Wyatt.
Yes, we have a picture of Wyatt and Nicholas Kontaxis. We went to we talked a lot. Well, last week we had Nicholas on the show, and Wyatt's eyes are closed there, but we got Nicholas, you know, happy and both of them mugging for the cameras.
Painting.
And that's in front of one of Nicholas Kontaxis's paintings, which apparently almost all the paintings sold. We told you about this remarkable young man. We had him on the show last week.
And his mom.
And his mother. He had intractable brain tumor, which led to him having autism symptoms and having autism. And he, about 3 years ago, his mother, who was an artist, developed a painting technique with him where he uses a palette knife to create these huge, large-scale paintings. There was a show on Saturday night, and it was a sellout. I mean, it was just incredible. I think all the paintings sold, and Act Today is one of the beneficiaries of that. Nicholas Kontaxis, a remarkably talented young man.
Really wonderful, and I'm glad that you had the opportunity to go and be there and that Wyatt got to see it, because Wyatt is a budding artist.
He is
amazing.
Yes, he just
artist.
Was named a finalist in the PTA Reflections
contest. Which just gives
contest.
Me chills.
His,
you know, and I had seen some of, Wyatt does a lot of work that you call the
Echo Art.
The Echo Art.
Uh-huh.
I keep saying Eco Art.
Eco,
because it's on
Echo, Eco.
Because it's
like
on recycled
cartons.
Yeah,
Starbucks cartons, wine cartons.
And they're absolutely stunning. He also does canvas work.
Yeah.
And, you know, I thought that Wyatt does some things that are very impressionist in nature.
Yes, he does.
But he also does other things as well. I'm stunned by some of the things that Wyatt does.
He is definitely an artist. He started painting when he was a year old.
And it's what he wants to do first thing in the morning, and it's what he wants to do at the end of the night.
It's his favorite thing.
Jem and I had a conversation about that the other day where we were talking about what do you want to fill your days with?
Right.
About a career. Like, what do you want to do with your life? What do you want to fill your days with? And we were at a swap meet, and somebody was selling flowers. And I mm-hmm. said, you know, how lovely for him, because he loves flowers mm-hmm. so much. And I said, what do you really got to think about? Not only, you know, what do I want to do for a job, but what do I want to fill my days with? And I said, let's talk about Wyatt. I mean, Wyatt gets up every morning and the first thing he goes to do is paint.
Right after breakfast, he paints.
And the last thing he does at the end of the day is paint.
Yes.
And he'll paint in the middle of the day if you give him 5 minutes in which to do it.
And bravo to the Kontaxis family for making that into a career. I mean, they probably, we're talking, some of these paintings were in the, you know, $10,000 range.
Well, Wyatt will be next. And how
thank
how
you from your
better,
lips to God's ears.
And listen, I have a direct line. And you couldn't have picked a better name. Wyatt Jackson is the name of an
Y-Art.
American artist. Right? Is
we
that
call it
is
Y-Art.
That the perfect name?
Wyatt. W-Y-A-R-T.
Which I think is great, because we're also going to talk about why you should support Wyatt.